This is the second lecture for Humanities 213, Week 4, covering Islam. Islam began among the Arabs, and even the Quran is only fully accepted in its Arabic language original. So this slide looks at the background, historical background, of certain Arab groups. The Arabs trace their lineage back to the Ishmaelites, and Ishmael was one of the sons of Abraham. A number of the groups who made up the ancient Arabs are known as the Children of the East, as they are called in Judges 6:3. Although there are a number of ancient settlements in the southern Arabian Peninsula area, the language, Arabic, is widespread in inscriptions around the Near East. They appear in the historical record in 853 BC as fighting against the Assyrians, and they are known for their camel-riding nomadic traders and raiders. There were other settlements closer to modern Israel and Syria, and even Paul early on ministered among the Arabs. As noted on the previous slide, one group of Arabs known as the Nabataeans established themselves in the area of Petra as early as the beginning of the 4th century BC. And here are a couple of pictures of these very famous rock facades in the area of Petra. This area is not far from modern-day Israel and is often included in tours of the Holy Land. Now, Islam means submission, and a Muslim is someone who has submitted to Allah. Again, it begins among the Arabs of the Arabian Peninsula, and they trace their origins back to Abraham, just as the Jewish people do. These early Arabs are Bedouin, but they're also urban Arabs. Arabic is the key language, and it is one of the Semitic languages, so it is related to Hebrew and Akkadian. And it must be kept in mind historically that early Islam is to some degree an Arab movement. And it was formed, it was founded at the time that there were Jewish and Christian communities in the Middle East. Thus, it is old, but it is not ancient. Christianity is even older than Islam. The founder of Islam is Muhammad the Prophet, who is of a certain tribe in Mecca on the Arabian Peninsula. Muhammad is certainly one of the most important figures in world history. When I was in college, I recall I would read a few books out of the library that covered the great historical figures. And usually the top five were, of course, Jesus and Paul and Luther, Sir Isaac Newton, and also Muhammad. He was a foundational religious leader and a great organizer of people. Now, we saw that the Buddha was an historical figure, but somewhat shrouded in legend. Hinduism has no official founder. So here we arrive at a religion that really we know about the historical founder. He was not a miracle worker. That's what he was not known for. but he had a message, and his message was understood as affirmed in early military victories. He was born in Mecca to a prominent family, and his first wife was Khadijah. And while she was alive, he had a monogamous relationship with her. He began proclaiming his message around AD 610. He was receiving visitations from the angel Gabriel, according to his testimony. The message was to abandon idolatry and to worship Allah, who is the only God, to repent of sin, to be honest in business, and to treat women and children, including orphans, better. But he went from a mere religious reformer to the founder of a religion. Of course, when somebody presents something so radical and new, there's going to be those who refuse it. So he experienced initial resistance from those in Mecca. He was espousing a faith that chose religious brotherhood instead of tribal identity for the foundation of society. Writes Lippmann, the Brotherhood of Islam, the Ummah or community of believers, has existed ever since in a bond of faith that transcends race and politics. The believers, says the Quran, are a band of brothers. 10 years later, in 620, he experienced a night journey wherein he was supernaturally taken to Jerusalem and then ascended to heaven. Of course, some scholars will say that this was more visionary than physical in nature. But I note here that even the Apostle Paul experienced a visionary trip to heaven. So this is not necessarily an odd claim. It is a supernatural claim. But I give you there Paul's own account of his experience in 2 Corinthians. In 622, because of rejection, Muhammad and others made a famous flight from Mecca to Yathrib, and this is the occasion of the beginning of the Arab calendar. This flight is known as the Hijra. Yathrib itself was renamed Medina, that is, the city of the Prophet. And there, Muhammad was allowed to carry on with his reforms because the political environment was less restrictive. In 624 is the Battle of Badr, which occurred on the road from Medina to Mecca, wherein those who followed Muhammad attacked a Meccan caravan, and it was an overwhelming victory for the Muslim side, and thus was seen as something affirming the message. Then, a few years later, was the Battle of the Trench at Medina, wherein the Meccans attacked, but were not victorious, and they withdrew. And thus, a treaty was made between the followers of Muhammad and Mecca in 628. Lippmann notes that a Medina Jewish tribe who had sided with the invading Meccans, and remember, Mecca is against Muhammad at this time, were treated severely for backing the Meccans. Quote, all the men, 600 to 800 in number, were beheaded. The women and children were sold into slavery. It should be noted that the treatment of the Jewish people in this case was not typical of Islam. But one does note in reading the literature
that there was this tension beginning with Muhammad of appreciating the Hebrew writings, but being very critical at times of the Jewish people.
The expansion of Islam is truly amazing historically. Sir Norman Anderson writes, quote, "The early expansion of Islam is one of the outstanding phenomena of history. Within 10 years of the death of its founder, Muhammad, Muslim armies had burst out of Arabia and conquered the countries we now know as Jordan, Israel, Lebanon, Syria, Iraq, Iran, and Egypt. Within 100 years of his death, they had swept across North Africa, conquered Spain, and penetrated southern France. And during the same period, they had swept east through Central Asia, poured into northern India, reached the confines of China, and built up an empire wider than that of Rome at her zenith." I note here the battle, famous Battle of Yarmouk, which took place in Syria in 636 AD. Considered one of the great military massacres of antiquity, and they defeated the Byzantine army. That is the army, you can call it perhaps the Christian army, of the Byzantine Empire based at Constantinople. It should be noted that conversions were not instantaneous when peoples were conquered, at the larger population level anyway. In the West, Muslim expansion was finally stopped in 732 at the Battle of Tours in what would be today France, wherein the Muslims were defeated by Charles Martel, literally Charles the Hammer, the Frank, who was the grandfather of the even more famous Charlemagne.
The following two slides give an historical overview of early Islam. Please just peruse these. Islam has a number of quote-unquote capitals that we should take a quick look at. Mecca, of course, is the religious capital of Islam. Baghdad, historically, was a prominent political capital. Damascus has been Islam's artistic capital, Damascus in Syria. And Cairo in Egypt is Islam's intellectual capital, with the leading Al-Azhar University, one of the oldest universities in the world.
There are two central beliefs of Islam. This is known as the Kalima, or the affirmation of faith. Simply put, there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of God. Islam does not recognize two separate spheres of existence, that is, the secular and religious spheres. The secular in Islam is part of the religious. Islam is an all-encompassing way of life. It is thus, in political vision, theocratic. Like Christianity, Islam seeks obedience. The difference, often though, is that Christianity, certainly it's hoped, only seeks the obedience of those who believe, while with Islam, the goal is the submission of everyone. Islam does not usually value the idea of its followers being persecuted, unlike Christianity, which values or finds value in rejection and persecution, which are part of God's plan. Though valuing the Jewish and Christian prophetic tradition, Islam sees itself as going beyond these two and as the final revelation. That is, Muhammad is the final prophet. Important texts, the Quran, of course, is the primary text. The Quran is understood as things communicated by the angel Gabriel to Muhammad. He did not receive Muhammad, his revelation direct from God. It came via the angel Gabriel. And it was received in a rather dictated form. That is, the Quran has no trace of Muhammad in its voice. At least it's held to be that way. The Quran is comprised of 114 surahs. Narrative content, stories, are minimal in the Quran. It is mainly a document that instructs. The text was established, that is, finished by 650 AD, and its Arabic is understood as being of a very high quality. So, Muhammad himself may have been illiterate. He may not have been able to read or write, but he had the text, the sayings he left, are of a very high literary quality. Other writings include the Hadith, or the tradition, which is sayings and practices of Muhammad, and Sharia, or holy law, which is an interpretation of the Hadith. And the Sharia, because it's the nature of it is interpretive, is still growing, still being added to. I always ask a test question about the five pillars of Islam. They are as follows. First is the affirmation of faith, which we just went over. The kalima, the creed, we might say. Creed is from the Latin word credo, I believe, but we use it in general for other statements of faith by religious groups. A second pillar is prayer, five times daily facing Mecca, especially on Fridays at noon. Sunday is the big day for Christians, Saturday for Jewish people, Friday for Muslims. Of course, Saturday is big for Christians such as the Seventh-day Adventists or the Seventh-day Baptists, but in general, Sunday for Christians, Saturday for the Jewish people, Friday for Muslims. Another pillar is fasting during the lunar month of Ramadan from dawn until sunset. Almsgiving, that is especially charity. And then at one point in a Muslim's life, a pilgrimage to Mecca to see the Kaaba, the cube. Of course, the Christian Sermon on the Mount has instructions about prayer and about fasting and about almsgiving, interestingly. My note here about the history of Near Eastern divine law. We saw that, you know, Islam arises in the Near East, and we saw that tradition when studying Mesopotamia of taking care of the widow and the orphan. Here you see almsgiving, which doesn't have to be just toward the poor, but certainly keeps in mind those in need in the community. And in a sense, carries on this Near Eastern tradition. Here is a prayer that a Muslim might recite. I'll let you read it for yourself. And then at the bottom, I note perhaps comparing the Lord's Prayer and the petitions of the Lord's Prayer in Christianity with this.
Here are some general Islamic terms when studying Islamic history. Especially note the definitions for Sunni and Shia.
Let's look at Islam's relationship to Judaism and Christianity. At first, Islam was favorable toward the Jewish people, although we did cover that one incident with the war during Muhammad's time. But due to discrepancies between the Old Testament and the Surahs, conflict with the Jewish people arose. There are things in the Quran that appear to not have certain aspects of the Old Testament down correctly. And when the Jewish scholars or people would point this out, it would lead to problems. The Quran recognizes 28 prophets, six of which brought new dispensations, including Adam, Noah, Abraham, Moses, Isa, Jesus, and Muhammad. What is Islam's view of Jesus? Islam recognizes Jesus was the Messiah, and that he was born of a virgin and can be called God's Word. It recognizes that Jesus was a miracle worker and one of the greatest prophets. But it holds that he was not divine. He was not God's son. And Islam does not believe that Jesus died on a cross. He only appeared to do so. Dying on a cross is a criminal's death, and it is no way for a great prophet such as Jesus to die. Here is a couple of passages from the Quran, and it is clear that the first one stands against confessional Christianity. He is Allah, the One, Allah, the eternally besought of all. He does not beget, neither was he begotten, and there is none comparable unto him, which directly contradicts, probably purposely, John 3:16, and of course contradicts creedal Christianity, for instance, the Nicene Creed. Here's something I found very interesting and very helpful in Neil's book. It is basically the Apostles' Creed, anything in italics is something that Islam would deny, but anything in regular type is something that Islam would affirm. And I'll let you work through this, and you can see, since the Apostles' Creed is one expression of Christian belief, how Islam would differ with some of the statements. Here are a few more differences between Christianity and Islam. Again, these are important to make because Islam affirms, actually affirms certain things that Christians believe. Christianity emphasizes God as Father and a God of love. The Quran does not identify Allah as a father. Islam does emphasize mercy toward other people and benevolence as well, toward the disadvantaged. So there's a similarity as well. Christianity does have a stronger sense of sin. For instance, in the Sermon on the Mount, it's not just the act of adultery, it's the unfaithfulness in the human heart, going to the very core of the being of the individual. Islam does hold to personal responsibility, but doesn't take it so far. And thus, it is a works-based religion for salvation, whereas Christianity, salvation is only through Christ. No one can earn or deserve salvation.
This slide notes that Islam has afforded a certain legal status for non-Muslims that it regards as peoples of the book, such as Christians and Jews. This slide covers that concept.
Early in the history of Islam, Christians in the Near East played an important role. The Christians were the scholars of the early period of Islam. It was often the Christians who translated the Greek classics into Arabic while under Muslim rule. Some Muslim architecture, in fact, is based on Christian architecture, as we'll see with something like the Dome of the Rock. The Muslim act of prostration derives from the Byzantine Christian practice. Ramadan and Lent are periods of fasting, and as late as the 11th century, Asia was still home to at least a third of the world's Christians, and perhaps a tenth of all Christians still living in Africa, a figure that the continent would not reach again until the 1960s. My point here being that conquered by Islam, the Christians were very much an integral part of Muslim society and provided much of the early scholarship. I note down at the bottom John of Damascus, sometimes thought of as the last of Christian fathers, as they're called, a Syrian who lived his life under Muslim rule and was an outstanding Christian scholar and wrote a very important disputation between a Christian and a Saracen, which is just another way of saying a Muslim.
Here is another lengthy quote by Jenkins about the importance of Christians in the early Islamic world. And while Muslims are often credited, as they are in Fierro, of preserving the scholarship of antiquity, it must also be noted that this scholarship was conveyed to Islam via Christian scholars who worked as scholars under Islamic rule.
In 1096, the first Western European crusade to take the Holy Land away from the Muslims occurred. And we will cover the crusades when we get to medieval Europe. But because we are Westerners, we put a lot of focus on those crusades. But they really weren't a very big deal for the general Muslim world at the time. But something happened after those crusades that was devastating to Islam, and that is a major invasion from the east of the Near East. We have already encountered the Mongols, a major branch controlled China, and at one time was led by the very famous Kublai Khan. Well, in 1219, another group of Mongols under the very famous Genghis Khan began to move west, and destruction followed in their wake. And as it notes here, in 1250, Genghis Khan's grandson, Hulagu, massacred 800,000 in the Muslim city of Baghdad. A major church was established there while the mosques were being destroyed. Why is that? Because Hulagu's wife was a Christian. There were Christians in league with the Mongol invaders. And as I note here, the Christians, in fact, associated with the Mongols, encouraged the Mongols to destroy Islam. And then about 10 years later, when the Mongols moved towards Egypt, the Egyptians countered and defeated the Mongol army, which was led by a Christian general, that is the Mongols. 8 years later, these Mamluk Egyptian Muslims took control of Syrian Antioch, which was held by the Christian crusaders, and because Christians had supported the previous Mongol campaign, the Christians suffered persecution, and their churches were destroyed. Interestingly, the Mongol rulers in the West gradually converted to Islam.
This slide notes how damaging the Mongol invasion was to Arab Islam. This slide covers Sufi mysticism, which is a major form of mysticism within Islam, named after the woolen robe worn by the Sufi mystics, and it arose in the 9th century. Like most mysticism, the goal is union with God. Mysticism, this is my definition, is direct personal apprehension of the divine. One does not need a priest. Mystics tend to operate on the margins of their religious groups because they are rather independently minded in this goal of union with God. Now, Sufi mysticism accepted women into its group, and that is not typical for Islam. Like many mystics, it involved asceticism, such as abstinence and self-imposed poverty and perhaps celibacy. Sufi mysticism, coming late as it did, was influenced by Greek Neoplatonism, and part of Neoplatonism usually is a downgrading of the body and its desires, and they were likely influenced by Christian and Buddhist mystics. This slide quotes at length a Muslim historian about how Christians were the bridge between ancient Greek learning and Islamic scholars. Islam produced a number of powerful philosophers. On this slide, I especially note Avicenna and Averroes, the third one there. Averroes especially was influential. If he didn't directly influence the Christian philosopher Thomas Aquinas in the Middle Ages, he certainly was the impetus for deeper and better reasoned philosophical speculation by Christian medieval philosophers such as Thomas Aquinas. Islamic scholars made great strides in the area of math and science. As was noted, they are a link between the Greco-Roman world of antiquity and the medieval world of Europe. Note that our use of their work includes the page numbers of practically any book you have. We call those Arabic numerals. And the terms zero, cipher, algebra, and almanac, and zenith come from Arabic. They preserved the Greek mathematical and scientific texts such as those of Aristotle, Euclid, Archimedes, and Ptolemy, building on that Greek heritage. And this information gradually made it to medieval Christianity in Western Europe, which up until about 1000 was pretty much an intellectual backwater, except for the little bit of education going on in Charlemagne's day. As far as astronomy, they preserved Ptolemy's Almagest, and Almagest is partially based in the Arabic language. They made original contributions in medicine, making the clinical distinction between measles and smallpox. In mathematics, they transferred Hindu numeration into Arabic numerals, and our terms algorithm and algebraic come from Arabic. Coming rather late in human history, Islamic art and architecture is a complex amalgamation of previous styles. And here I'm especially looking at architecture. From the Greco-Roman world, Islam inherited the column. From Christian Byzantium, the pendentive dome, that is, a dome that utilizes a feature known as a pendentive to comfortably rest a round dome on a square base. We'll look at the pendentive when we get to ancient Christianity. And from the Persians, Islam inherited the pointed arch and floral and geometric ornamentation. One thing to note strongly about Islamic art is that it prohibits figurative art, that is, anything that can be called representational art, especially of living creatures, including people. The dominant architectural structure of Islam is the mosque, which is a place of prayer and is always oriented toward Mecca. It is usually a rectangular building with an open courtyard and a fountain in the center of the courtyard. Plain exteriors, ornate interiors. Sometimes melon-shaped domes are associated with mosque structures. And finally, the minaret or tower, which calls people to prayer, is another feature of Islamic architecture and often associated with mosques. The next two slides show pictures of the Ibn Tulun Mosque in Cairo, Egypt. Quite old, 868. What you're actually looking at in this picture in the foreground is the fountain in the middle of the courtyard, capped with a dome. If you'll notice, the dome itself is resting on a level or a layer that is eight-sided, that is octagonal. We are going to look at that quite closely when we get to ancient Christianity. Islam is getting this style in some way from the Christians, who got it from the Romans before them. But this is the fountain in the center of the courtyard. Beyond it you see the mosque and the minaret tower. Here is the Shia Islam Latfala Mosque in Iran. Shia Islam is the dominant form of Islam in Iran. And we see here the Great Dome. Here's a detail of the interior of the Latfala Mosque. Note that it is basically geometrical and somewhat floral forms involved. No animals or humans, icons, that kind of thing. Very much within the directives of the Quran. The next two slides show photos of the Holy Kaaba Mosque in Mecca. And especially the second one will give you an idea of just how many people are there. And they are there to pray. A couple of famous Islamic buildings noted in your book include the Cordoba Mosque of Spain. Recall that Spain, or Muslims, controlled much of the Spanish Peninsula up until the early 2nd millennium AD. The last Muslims were driven out of Spain in 1492. The same year Columbus discovered the New World. The Cordoba Mosque is now a Christian church. because Islam no longer dominates the area. And then there's the Dome of the Rock, perhaps the hottest spot in the world geopolitically. Its architecture is designed by, or excuse me, influenced by the Church of the Holy Sepulchre and the church known as San Vitale in Ravenna. Again, Christian influence on Islamic culture. The Dome of the Rock, you'll note, is octagonal and capped with a dome. It is the first major Islamic monument, and you can see it was built very early, 691, very early, that is, in the history of Islam. Please note, it is not a mosque. Often it is referred to as a mosque. It is not a mosque. It is a shrine. It is a shrine, a memorial over the rock where Muhammad is said to have ascended to heaven in that night journey. A couple other famous Islamic buildings include the Taj Mahal in India, which actually is a shrine or mausoleum built to honor the wife of Shah Jahan, and the Alhambra Palace, like the Cordoba Mosque in Spain. One thing to note as you go a couple of slides in about the Alhambra Mosque is the fountain with lions surrounding it. This is a rare instance of representational art, or representation, I should say, in Islamic art. Very rare. Here is the tomb of Tamerlan, the Muslim-Mongol leader. This tomb was in the ancient city of Samarkand, which today would be in Uzbekistan, Central Asia. It is common in memorial architecture for a tomb to be covered by a dome, going back at least to the time of the Romans, but certainly even all the way back to what we've seen with the Mycenaean Greeks in the treasury of Atreus. So I want to point this out. It is a piece of Islamic architecture, but it carries on a tradition from long before, and we're going to look at that tradition, the Dome of Heaven, more closely when we get to ancient Christianity.
Who was this Tamerlane? He was, as I noted, the Muslim-Mongol leader who destroyed villages in the Near East. He claimed descent from Genghis Khan, and few deny this. Not only was he related to Genghis Khan, but would have also been related to Kublai Khan, the ruler of China. This is how far-flung and powerful, military-wise, these Mongols were. I find this to be an area of future research for me, because I'm also fascinated by the Christians involved with these Mongol rulers.
As far as Islamic literature, we've already noted the religious texts such as the Quran and the Hadith, and also on a slide was noted certain works of the Sufi poets. Finally, we'll note the Thousand and One Nights, which contains stories found in the Arabic and Persian worlds. And The Thousand and One Nights reflects on the cultural and artistic history of the Arab Islamic tradition and features such characters as Aladdin, Sinbad, and Ali Baba. And interestingly, the name Gilgamesh appears in The Thousand and One Nights. It's slightly changed, but scholars know that it is Gilgamesh, the name being used, although it's not the Epic of Gilgamesh that is being spoken of. But Gilgamesh's name survived even this late in the Near East.